3:18, for Christ also suffered for sins, once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, in order to bring you to God. He was put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit. Whole, and by his bruises we were healed. All we, like sheep, have gone astray. We have all turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all.
Amazing grace shall always be my song of praise, for it was grace just why he came to love me so.
Now, can we do it from the top, Amazing Grace?
Amazing Grace shall always be my song of praise, for it was grace that bought my liberty. I do not know just why he came to love me so. He looked beyond my fault.
Let's sing Amazing Grace one more time. Amazing Grace.
Amazing Grace shall always be my song of praise, for it was grace that bought my liberty.
Do you believe that this morning?
I do not know just why he came to love me so. He looked beyond my faultless.
One more time, Amazing Grace.
Amazing Grace shall always be my song of praise, for it was grace that bought my liberty. I do not know just why he came to love me so. He looked beyond my faults and saw my.
I don't know about you this morning, but that verse is speaking to my heart. He looked beyond my faults and saw my needs. I don't know about you, but he looked beyond my faults.
Amen.
And saw my needs. If you believe that this morning, come on.
Praising my Savior all the day long.
Amen. Amen. Go with me, if you would, to... back to 2 Kings 5, and we're going to look at verses, I believe, 19 through 27. So I get myself together here. 2 Kings 5, and this... what Ron read earlier, this is the end of that episode. And it reads, he said to him, go in peace. But when Naaman had gone from him a short distance, Gehazi, the servant of Elisha, the man of God, thought, my master has let that Aramean or Syrian Naaman off too lightly, but not accepting from him what he offered. As the Lord lives, I will run after him and get something out of him. So Gehazi went after Naaman, and when Naaman saw someone running after him, he jumped down from his chariot to meet him and said, is everything all right? And he replied, yes, but my master has sent me to say, two members of a company of prophets have just come to me from the hill country of Ephraim. Please give them a talent of silver and two changes of clothing. Naaman said, please accept two talents. He urged him and tied up two talents of silver in two bags with two changes of clothing and gave them to two of his servants, whom carried them in front of Gehazi. When he came to the citadel, he took the bags from them and stored them inside. He dismissed the men, and they left. He went in, stood before his master Elisha, and said to him, where have you seen Gehazi? Where were you? Where have you been, Gehazi? And he answered, your servant has not gone anywhere at all, really. But he said to him, did I not go with you in spirit when someone left this chariot to meet you? In this time to accept money and accept clothing, olive orchards and vineyards, sheep and oxen and male and female slaves. Therefore, the leprosy of Naaman shall cling to you and your descendants forever. So he left his presence leprous, as white as snow. Lord, you have to help me now. Bless your people. Bless this word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Somebody say amen with me. Amen. Amen. Okay, so you all know how we do this. I'm going to need you to help me to preach. Amen? Amen. If you don't know, I'm clumsy. I sprained my ankle. And I think what happened, I was carrying a case of water up the stairs to my deck. And the bag swung and hit my ankle. And my ankle has not been right for like 3 days. So I'm in somewhat pain. So if you help me preach, that means I'll forget about my ankle. Amen?
Amen?
Amen. So let me start with this. The title is Blessing Hustle. The Blessing Hustle. Or Blessing Hustler. I'm waiting for Steve to catch up with me. There you go. Right? Scam alert. Hustler. I like that. Let's start with defining terms. A hustle is to seek out to acquire sums of money, usually large sums, by unscrupulous means. In this context, we are talking about attaining a blessing by unscrupulous means. Keep that definition in mind as we navigate this morning's meditation. Also, let me state in the clearest of terms, God has blessings with your name on it. Unequivocally, what God has for you is for you, and nobody can access those blessings but you. Amen. Follow me now. Yes. It's also true, good deeds deserve a reward. The reward, I heard one amen on that one. The reward may be nothing more than a genuine expression of thankfulness, but a good deed does deserve appreciation. But a deed is only deserving of reward when it is done without a desire for recompense or compensation. There are some things in life that we ought to be willing to do without a reward, like raising our children and giving them the best education possible, making sure our church has what it needs to be effective in the community. And if we had our hand out every time we gave our time and talents to aid someone else, our acts would be nothing more than selfish gestures. Selfish, y'all not saying amen with me. All right. Selfish deeds are motivated by a philosophy that says, give me more. Our seemingly insatiable desire for more often drives us in the wrong direction. And if we're not careful to resist the temptation for more and more, when God gives us an orange, we just might hand it back and say, peel it. Our scripture text this morning comes from a familiar story. The story of Naaman the leper. He was commander in the Aramean army, modern day Syria. And one day an Israelite slave girl became Naaman's salvation. That nameless, bold girl, little girl, had compassion on Naaman and told his wife to send him to Elijah for healing. Another servant overheard the remarks and told the king. The king also reacted with compassion and sent Naaman to Elijah with a legal letter requesting healing for his beloved commander of his army. At first, Elijah was skeptical of the king. Let me put a pin in it right there. Our job is to speak truth to power always. Let me say it again. Our job as the people of God is to speak truth to power always. Listen to me. Oftentimes, folk with political influence befriend preachers, religious leaders, and laity to have access to your influence in the community. Sometimes, let me say it again. People befriend you to have access to your influence in the community. And so you should always have a healthy skepticism. Elijah was skeptical for that very reason. And we should be too for that very reason. Sometimes, as I said before, folks are not interested in you, but to borrow your credibility or your cultural capital to get what they want. You're just the means to what they want. But Elisha finally sees the opportunity to demonstrate the power of God. And it's always good to be on the lookout for opportunities to witness the goodness of God. Most of us know the next part of the story. Elisha sent a messenger to greet Naaman with this message: go and wash 7 times in the Jordan. Naaman was incensed. He was angry. He was perturbed. He was visibly frustrated. Not only was the Jordan a very muddy river, but Naaman felt, how dare this prophet refuse to come to me and pray to his mighty God for deliverance from leprosy? Outraged and disappointed, his privilege was showing and coming to bear. He's saying, How dare I be asked to go into the Jordan where the poor folks have to tread? How dare I have to go into the bad neighborhood where the folks who are on public assistance have to tread? How dare I go from my nice suburban neighborhood to where all the people live in the ghetto to have to get healed, to hear a word from God? Naaman is saying, don't you know who I am? I'm Naaman, the captain of the army. Naaman is upset. He started from home. He said, screw that blessing. I'll just go home. But his servant approached him and boldly pointed out to Naaman that he was being arrogant and stubborn. And one servant said, if he told you to do some great thing, would you have not done it? Ashamed of his actions, Naaman went to the Jordan and dipped himself 7 times. And on that 7th dip, and not a moment sooner, he was healed. The story is about a blessing. It's about Elisha and Naaman. But there is a third character worth noting in this narrative. And each of the three is worth a closer look. First, the giver. Elisha, we expect integrity and truthfulness as a prophet of God. When Naaman and his entourage pulled up to Elisha's humble dwelling, it was clear he expected the prophet to rush out and greet him. Naaman had no intention of dismounting and entering this humble home. Why? Because in Naaman's mind, going into this home is beneath him. Going into the homeless shelter is beneath him. But Elijah saw what Naaman needed: a rebuke of his pride and self-conceit. The Jordan River was just a suggestion to accomplish that. After all, God can do anything with nothing. So this muddy river is the conduit. Elisha knew that he was just the conduit for God's blessing. He knew that all blessings come from the Lord. And maybe that's why Elisha chose to send the messenger out to Naaman, directing him to wash in the Jordan. Preachers today are God's prophets. You are God's priests in the world. There's nothing blocking anyone from the saving grace of God other than our own humble repentance. God knows all about us. There's nothing we could possibly do to impress God. We don't deserve salvation, but God offers it. He wants us to take that walk down to the muddy river and allow his living water to cleanse all of us from unrighteousness. Then there is the receiver, Naaman. Naaman is an illustration of the imperfection found in all of us, right? He was a man who was a mighty warrior, a good soldier. He had won many battles. His cup of happiness was almost full. But with all the triumphant shouts from the grateful multitude, there was still one thing that hampered his complete happiness. He was a warrior, but he was a leper. She's a good singer, but she's a leper. Good husband, but a leper. Good preacher, but a leper. Y'all feeling me in this? He's a good man, but he's got a bad temper. She's a nice woman, but she doesn't work well with others. He would be a great asset to the church, but he's too inconsistent. Here's the thing. If our life's contradictions and inconsistencies and problem areas become the means by which we are driven to God, then that's good news. Only God can use our deficiencies and draw us closer the hymn. And this is what I'm trying to get you to see. In the ancient world, leprosy was considered to be the result of sin. It was believed that it could only be cured through purification rituals. That's the kind of detailed instruction Naaman was looking for. He would have light. But that's not how God works. To receive his blessing, Naaman had to humble himself and accept the gift of healing in the most simplistic of terms, in form, in a muddy river. What will you do to be blessed? Where will you go to hear a word from the Lord? What will you do to be blessed? How long will you pray to be blessed? Where will you go to be blessed? Some of us want a blessing, but we're not anxious to go down to the bad parts of the town. Some of us want a blessing, but we're not anxious to go into the homeless shelter. Some of us want a blessing, but we're not anxious to feed the homeless. Some of us want a blessing, but we're not anxious to get involved in justice issues. Some of us want a blessing, but we're not anxious to follow God's instruction because there's no glory in it. Some folk act and move in a way that if they're going to move in God's instruction, they want it to be for some good grand cause that they're doing for God, or better still, some spectacular thing that God is doing for them. We're not anxious to do the little things, to put in the long, hear me, secret hours in the kitchen, cooking and cleaning to raise money. Check on the welfare of members just because you care, or simply make the difficult sacrifices that God sometimes requires. And because of that, we are sometimes missing our blessing. Imagine the joy Naaman felt when he finally obeyed and saw the result of his obedience to God. The scripture says that he was a changed man. He hopped on his chariot and his whole consort behind him, and he made haste back to Elisha. Why? Because Naaman had been saved, and he wanted to offer Elisha a reward for his healing. But Elisha knew that there was no amount of money that he could pay for God's grace. It was a non-negotiable mercy. So he refused Naaman's offer. Y'all still with me? But something in Naaman had changed. Nowhere in Scripture is there a more profound confession of faith than the one he made to Elisha. The healed Armenian, the Syrian, returned to acknowledge the sole supremacy of Jehovah. The Phoenicians believed in Baal. The Syrians believed in Ammon and Rimmon. The Babylonians believed in Baal. And the Egyptians believed in Ra and Umara. But get this. All foreign nations referred to Jehovah as the God of the Jews, God with a small g. But after Naaman's conversion, he declared that to Elijah, with "Behold, now I know there is no God in all the earth but in Israel," with a big G. Y'all still with me? Naaman put a capital G on the God of Jehovah, not one God among many, but one God in all the earth. That's a change. That's a turnaround, right? What can we pay God for our healing from soul sickness or cancer or pain, emotional trauma? What can we offer God for so great a gift of salvation? Naaman offered a great reward, but Elisha refused to accept it. Though Naaman's offer was sincere, it was important for him to realize that God's blessings are given without restriction or price. God's blessing are given without pertains to color, whether you're man or woman, gay or straight. God's blessing with your name on it belongs to you. Gifts and callings are given without repentance. That's in the book. Finally, there is the hustler, Gehazi. We don't talk much about Gehazi, Elisha's servant. Gehazi was a witness to Naaman's offer and Elisha's refusal to accept the great gift. He may not have known its value, but he was persuaded to believe that an Armenian ought to give something for Jehovah. Who is this guy that he would come and get a blessing from our God and not give something? Who is he? It's interesting. In the text, it says that as the Lord lives, Gehazi says, as the Lord lives, I will run after Naaman and take something from him. As the Lord lives, huh? Those are strange words to come out of the mouth of someone who was hell-bent on lying and stealing, right? Right? But the experience teaches us that even religious people commit crazy acts of dumbness, right? Here's why. When our religion becomes a habit, it can lose its daily influence on us. And we become blind to our own actions, and our habitual acts can take us down a path towards personal profit. We become full of excuses. I deserve something for all of my hard work. I should be recognized for all of my dedication. I'm justified in keeping something for all of my devotion. Gehazi was full of excuses. He had a personal agenda to land himself an unearned, a pinch, pilfered, and hustled blessing. His exterior hypocrisy was showing off his interior crud. Gehazi followed after Naaman and hustled him out of a generous reward. He lied and said that Elijah had second thoughts, that Elijah had sent him to ask for a gift for two new ministers under his tutelage. Naaman doubled the request and sent two guards with Gehazi to ensure their safe arrival, so with such a great cargo. But devious Gehazi relieved the guards before they got back to Elisha's house. The stolen, hustled blessing was going to be his and his alone. Isn't it amazing how crafty we can be when we're out to get something that don't rightfully belong to us, right? Whether it was a raise or you know, you wanted a raise and even though you're always late to work, or you wanted a loan from a friend and you hadn't paid back the first one, right? That's what Gehazi was doing, right? He was hustling a blessing. And when we take something we have not earned, we cannot expect anything good to come out of it. Elijah asked Gehazi, where have you been? And then he lied and said, I've been here the whole time. Right? I've been here the whole time. And Elijah said to him, come on, you know better than that. Wasn't my heart with you when you followed after Naaman? You have no right to reward you demanded. The leprosy God removed from Naaman will be yours to claim from now on and your descendants. And he left out of his presence as a leper, as white as snow. Gehazi had been with Elisha for a long time. He had been one of his closest companions. He had witnessed miracles. He witnessed patience, self-denial, gentleness, his kindness, and his zeal for the Lord. And just because someone, here's the part I'm getting to, just because someone walks with you, serves on the same church board, gives big offerings, doesn't mean the word of God has grown deep roots into them. We get good at putting on the church face and behavior. Spending all that time with Elijah didn't do anything for Gehazi but harden his heart. Gehazi grew proud and contemptuous, calling Naaman that Armenian, that Syrian, that, you know. I was going to name some names, but I didn't want to go that far. Gehazi, I'm almost done. Amen. That's the first amen he said all day. I love you. I love you, Dave. Gehazi is a sad case, but it's not unusual. Like Naaman, we too have been the brunt of some undeserved labels. And we probably responded with a few terse labels of our own. That's what happens when we resist the impulse to follow Elijah's example or Jesus' example to do good. And we do ourselves great harm. And when we blunt our consciousness and harden our hearts, we render ourselves less sensitive to the Holy Spirit than the influence of God. Here's the thing. Here's the thing I want you to see. As servants of the Lord, we can rise to the highest level of righteousness, or we can plummet to the lower levels of deterioration. For example, I'm going to leave you with this. Come on, praise team. Two of Jesus' closest friends were John and Judas. One was labeled the beloved disciple, while the other was labeled a traitor. God never takes away our free will. The choice is always ours to make. If you want to be blessed, just wait on God. God is going to bless you. God will supply all of your needs according to his riches and glory. His supply is sufficient to bless, to satisfy you. God's righteousness is sufficient to clothe you. God's riches are sufficient to enrich you. If you need a blessing, all you have to do is trust God. Trust God for his blessings of mercy, his blessings of forgiveness, his blessings of grace, redemption, and his...